first things on the agenda is a request for a modification of tree planting for 155 Pleasant Street. Carolyn is in presentation.
I think Peter's here. Should be the presentation. I think you're here to do the presentation, Peter.
In terms of presentation, I was going to distribute materials. It looks like you might already have that. And then give an explanation of context to attending. Yes. Well, we have to hear the voting question back because over the summer, all right, so I'm going to call in. This is for 155 Pleasant Street. It's been redeveloped by Hamp. And project's 4.5 years long at this point. And during the summer, National Grid told us they can't bring power onto the site the way they had explained 4 years ago. There's no longer a big cable that runs around the building. We have to put in a vault. And if you look at the drawing on the left, you see a little line that says easement for Mass Electric. That vault has to go in there. And unfortunately, there are any trees there. I can point that out if somebody. Right in this area, is it? It's not.
Okay.
I'm sorry. So, you don't have a projector here.
We do, but it's being used.
It's crowded up into the roots where these tree is, they're not going to survive. The arborist has suggested that they be taken down. And we propose some 34-38 inches of caliber of trees because as this is the
They'd be in a different spot, well, because you're going to have a box of some kind there?
Yes, they're going to be throughout. Much of it was already intended, but we've identified specifically the canopy trees. And then there are understory trees, which will actually get fairly large, but you may be like birches. They come in multiple steps, and they start small, but come in. You have a canopy tree. Anyway, my intention is to answer questions. I'm surprised it seems pretty difficult.
So let me just clarify. So you all approved the site plan for the project, and you know, there are three levels of review, essentially the way we look at it from that perspective is some of them are minor changes. There might be just tweaking of location items on the site that staff could approve with DPW or planning. And then I would say the next threshold would be sort of an administrative amendment by the planning board without filing a full-blown amendment that goes through the public hearing and advertising requirements. So they're asking to sort of come in at that middle, in-between level.
So remind me what, I did not dig up the four-year-old plans, but we did have a tree planting plan then.
Yes.
Right, so the plans that were e-forwarded to you electronically show the, so basically it was the three locusts in the back which were remain, and then there was another maple tree that was to remain as well. I believe the maple tree came down inadvertently before, and we were going to complete that on the site. Are the locusts still there?
Yes.
Okay, so the locusts are still there. That's really the only change on the plan, or sort of those are identified via the locusts in the back, and then that maple was to remain. And then you approved essentially everything else except for the addition of now these new trees that they're proposing to offset the removal of those other trees.
So just to clarify, so we've got four trees coming out, two trees are proposed to go back in.
Two additional trees, because we had a great deal already in the annual that were counted for our
right. But the change from what was approved before is minus four plus two.
Effectively.
Yes. Which I get easements and I get the fact that we got to respond to the electric company. My only concern would be we're replacing 24-inch and 20-inch, and then the smallest is a 6-inch caliper tree with 2-inch calipers. So the switch from removing four and replacing two quantity-wise, I guess I don't necessarily have an issue with, if the trees can't stay, because the utilities won't allow it, and can't stay, but I would argue to get a more robust cap on tree needs.
Any other thoughts?
Just, I was kind of going along the same lines, the four and the two, but is the total caliber measurement being accounted?
No.
So why wouldn't this be?
Well, so there are a couple, there are two, a couple different things. One is, we have a new standard that was just adopted at the earlier part of this year for, in the event that significant trees are removed over 20-inch DBH. There's a replacement calculation for those. This project came in before that ordinance came into effect. So at,
But now they're asking for a change.
They're asking?
After the other ordinance is in place.
Right, so the other that's true, but the other calculation that they submitted was showing, I think an evaluation over all of the total number of trees that they're replacing. And I think it was like 4 inches shy of the
yes.
number, so, 4 caliber inches shy of meeting the standard if they were under those guidelines today. They were under.
Which is why we're adding two more.
So it goes back to your question, -4 + 2, but then when you pull in all the other trees that you all approved under the landscape plan originally.
But those were already approved as this, again, this is a change from what was approved, which still seems like a loss from what was approved.
Let me phrase it slightly differently. I mean, I'm sorry not to have the existing survey there. There might be 18 trees existing, and we're probably coming back with close to 50 trees.
Okay.
And that's the difference where we make up that caliber.
Where we get to the only the four difference.
Right.
Okay, sorry. That's what it was.
Yeah.
Sorry, I wasn't clear about that.
Any other questions? Okay. Yeah, that's the piece I wanted to get to. If in the beginning there weren't as many trees on this lot, we loved the plan that came before us previously. I'm sorry about the electric box.
It's your fault.
How big is the vault?
Size of that table down.
Darn. So, any other thoughts, sir?
I mean, I guess, again, my concern would be either to bulk up. If we have the opportunity, you know, there's a net loss in caliber, I'm not looking for a one for one, but a good faith effort, I think, would be a 2-inch caliber tree is a standard nursery tree that's got a lot of years to grow before it reaches the size of the trees that we're losing. So just like we lost 20 but replaced it with 50, you know, to compensate for that loss, here we're losing 4, replacing 2. And either increase the quantity, if we can squeeze another tree in somewhere of a 2-inch caliper, or increase the caliper of these two trees, would be my preference to get something more representative of what we're losing.
I mean, alternatively, I mean, this is also a tight site, and I think the landscape architect, I'm not going to vouch for the landscape architect's design in that, confirming that it's the maximum number of trees that can go on the site. So I think they could potentially look at that, but there you do have the alternative of asking for that one tree to be planted somewhere else on Pleasant Street or in downtown somewhere, sort of to make up for that because we have that allowance in the new ordinance. So if you felt like it was one tree and the applicant couldn't plant it on site, maybe they could, you know, donate in accordance to the ordinance to the city to be planted in a public way someplace.
I'm hearing Mark say that he would rather have a larger tree if he could because then it's a more stable tree.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, either was an either or thing. So my preference would be a larger caliber because that's more representative of what we're losing.
I was thinking numbers.
If we did the numbers game instead and we can't fit that additional tree or trees on the lot, I didn't realize that was an option, so I would be fine with that. It's just that, you know, when you're losing a 24-inch caliber and replacing a 2-inch caliber, that's substantial.
Well, maybe you want to then allow them to do a little bit more work to see if it makes more sense to do
a larger tree, a larger caliber planting, and if that doesn't work, then they could come back and say, that doesn't work, we're going to opt to do the off-site planting. You know, if that sounds like, you know, an alternative that makes sense to you.
I'd like to see that, a good faith effort to see if, I would imagine, you know, what kind of trees people were talking about replacing these.
One of the honey locusts is a pin.
So I would imagine those are available in a larger caliber size.
But also fast-growing trees.
Yeah. The other thing, though, we have to, I mean, the larger tree grid gets, the less happy to be transplanted, so there is a diminishing return on that story. I kind of think we can settle this. I'm sending you back. I mean, I think we. I'm interested in one of the trees you're proposing being larger.
Okay. I'm sure the owner would be amenable to that.
Yeah, and that would come, you know, halfway to the four inch loss. Is that good faith enough?
Do you want to? I think it would be best to set the caliper. So if it's not 2 inch, you want 4 inch.
Yeah, give us instead of two inch trees, give us 2 4-inch trees, and I think that'd be
good.
Yeah. Could I get a proposal for that, please, so that we can actually vote and give Carolyn that permission? Proposal.
Motion to approve change to tree removal at 155 Pleasant Street to replace 3 existing trees with 2 new trees and 4 calipers each.
And second, all in favor? Thank you.
Thank you. Judy?
Second item on the agenda.
My bad. Multiple printouts of the text. You because this is for the initial conversation. I've got small copies of this too. So this map represents, the current industrial zones in the city. So we've got, we sort of have three industrial-like zones. There's general industrial, office industrial, and then we've got the business park, which is just on East Hampton Road, out towards East Hampton. So this discussion is really about coming back and rethinking the general industrial and office industrial. Over the last couple of years, you all have looked at and City Council has adopted modifications to each of those districts that allow buildings to be taller. 45 feet is the maximum now. There's been tweaks to the parking arrangements to allow a little bit more flexibility, particularly in the industrial park and in the general industrial district. And looking at open space and parking. So now the two zones are very similar. The real differences between the general industrial and office industrial, the difference is that general industrial allows warehousing, like large truck warehousing, like C&S wholesaler type of warehousing. Office industrial doesn't. And if you notice on this map, the purple color are the general industrial zone. So the industrial park would, that's got close proximity to the interstate, so potentially there might be such a use. I don't think we've ever really had one. This is warehousing that's not associated with manufacturing of any sort. So Coca-Cola has a lot of trucks coming in. It's not considered a warehousing use. It's a, industrial manufacturing use. There's that, and then we've allowed residential above the first floor in the office industrial. The office industrial districts have typically been the, for the most part, they're all over the old mill buildings in town. So we've got, except for Route 9 is probably the one exception. We have a silk mill, but then there's some other buildings in that district and wrapping around on Hatfield Street that are in the office industrial district. So sort of a lighter industrial zone historically, except the changes over the years have sort of brought them much closer together. And then down the Yankee Machine Shop down on the corner of Riverside Gardens, and the Cutlery Building, that's in the office industrial, multi-story mill building. And then, of course, the cluster in Florence, both along the bike path in Florence Center, and then also 2 Pine Street, Mills, that whole area. Industrial district, the general industrial district, is still applicable for the, I guess it's the Pro Brush Building on the other side of Pine Spring Street, is still general industrial, and then there's a little bit of industrial on the other side of West Street. It's per store, and then there are a couple of old mill buildings where there are some trades off uses, and in fact, some residential, I think they may have been old mill housing down there on Riverside Drive, is zoned industrial. So we started thinking internally about looking at modifications to office industrial that covers most of these old mill buildings to think about ways that we can encourage more flexible use for buildings, because there's several buildings that really just aren't, haven't been able to capture or been completely occupied. So 221 Pine Street has not always been fully occupied, and some of the other buildings have struggled to get tenants. And so,
what can't they do? Yeah, that's
was not allowed, and has always been retail, restaurants have been only allowed as a percentage or and by special permit, athletic clubs, health, fitness kinds of things have not been allowed. Basically anything that's commercial that we allow in downtown or general business or center. What generated this conversation was trying to figure out a way that and housing above the first floor has only been allowed in the context of live workspace. So one of the problems with creating residential components in these buildings is the building code, and but also the requirement that anyone who lives there has to work in that same building as opposed to just playing it for residential use. And part of the reason for maintaining that distinction and limit on sort of the new uses or the retail restaurant kind of uses has been a concern that we would lose industrial space, and that these are the only places we have allowed sort of the what uses may not be so compatible with residential. And so there's been a long period in which this city policy has been, let's keep that, you know, set aside for industrial, because retail and restaurant can go in a lot of different places. But we sort of thought maybe it's time to rethink that, to allow greater flexibility. The machine shop is coming on the market, or was, it is on the market. I don't know if anybody's looking at it, but that's a huge building. And it's hard to think about what, you know, one end user coming in and taking that whole space and using it. And we've had inquiries about people potentially converting it to residential, which isn't currently allowed, sort of standalone residential units. The idea was to think about allowing some retail and restaurant without special permit, residential above the first floor in these older buildings, and a little bit more flexibility on medical office reuse, which you all may remember that was done for some. There's currently now 30% of a building allowance for medical use in these buildings, but sort of broadening that a little bit to maybe 50%. So as we looked at this, we started thinking about, does it make sense even to have two distinct districts, because they're so similar anyway? Should we just open it up or create one industrial district instead of having a distinction between OI and NGM? So I guess there are two parts of the conversation. One is the merger, and the other is allowing a lot more flexibility for those older mill buildings.
There's no place in the industrial section of the residential.
The only place right now is the light blue, but residential is allowed as part of live work.
So no, but
in the industrial park.
In the industrial park? No.
Right. So you would be talking about adding more residences and then talking about merging it into.
Right. So the idea is still to have residential above the first floor. All the buildings in the industrial park are one-story buildings.
There are some pre-existing residential buildings in industrial park close to where it is.
Like Bradford Street and such.
Right. Yeah. So those are currently non-conforming. They'd still be non-conforming as single family homes. The way that I think we would recommend that you might want to consider is only allow residential above the first floor. That encourages a couple things. One is it might really be focused more towards those older mill buildings that probably need or could potentially give them greater flexibility for reusing the investment and preservation. And then, I guess, secondarily, if someone were to build a two-story new building what's now the general industrial district, that would require someone moving into the second floor to really, I mean, they'll know going in if they're moving above whatever industrial use or potentially office, because we do allow back office in not retail office like banking or typically, you know, law office banking. Originally, real estate offices was considered sort of more of a retail foot kind of traffic office space.
So what you actually envision is more of the office industrial being opened up to more uses rather than merging the two and finding that the general industrial would change over.
Right.
But why merge? I understand the residential part, but why merge them?
I guess part of it is for simplicity's sake, and it's not clear that there's a need to have two different types of industrial districts if we can't really define the difference between the two, and it might encourage multi-story buildings in the general industrial district down the road.
I will say your timing for proposing warehouses become residential units is interesting.
That's a building approach. We enforce the building code in a way that Oakland doesn't. So I think it was a practical matter, 220 Pine is probably not in a residential because the building code. One of the reasons for doing this is we with some regularity are moving back and forth between GI and OI, particularly from GI to OI. So it just adds confusion. Somebody wants to redo a property. So 220 Pine Street used to be GI, we just rezoned it to OI a few years ago. More recently, the non-top building, Matt McDonald's, we rezoned from GI to OI. So we keep doing it, it's time consuming for us, and it's not fair for developers to make some certain investment part. I don't know what the cost is.
Can I say something? I think more depends on the development, depends on the demand, the supply. What is the demand for housing, for the housing? What kind of studies are you having in terms of development? What does he need of him? Maybe to see, but I think I'm a net perspective. What industrial buildings?
So what's it? Is it housing? One thing driving development with him for the last 20 years. So our population has dropped for 20 years, and it was stable for 30 years before that. But in that time, our average number of people per dwelling, basically from World War II to now, we have half as many people per dwelling. Mm-hmm. So since World War II, we needed twice as many housing units to house the same number of people. Mm-hmm. But our unit size has dropped some, a lot more condos now than we had 20 years ago. But it hasn't dropped nearly as much as potentially the market wants. You know, the number of people who need a 2,400 square foot suburban home has dropped. We have a lot more elderly, both singles and young people. And so science is multifamily units. You know, prove to provide a housing need that we have, just the smaller units in a more urban environment. And the footprint is smaller, it's a lot less land, so there's a lot of money. Frankly, part of the reason we had a discussion tonight is in this space we're focused a little bit on public health and walkable neighborhoods, which sort of this other change shifts that environment.
But so also to piggyback on that, maybe help answer the question, over the years we've also had inquiries by people who want to be able to reinvest in buildings, particularly the older mill buildings, and they want to know if they can be residential. And the answer has always been only if it's live workspace, so artist studios or something of that sort. So there, we know there are some cases where there's some illegal by zoning residential units because the people who live there don't work there. And so the zoning isn't intended to correct those non-conformities, but to acknowledge that there is still an interest for people to live in older mill buildings. We also know that we've got this huge historic building that's on market that's going to be difficult to reuse, and we know there's demand for more housing. John,
just off the top, but I think the making the OI as accommodating and flexible and all of those things for residential and other, I think that fits with all the lots of discussions we've had over the last several years, especially the feedback we've gotten from people about what they like, what they don't like. The next part, the going converting the GI to OI, that also seems like it matches with some of the comments we've gotten, and that feels like that's going maybe a step too far to say, I think you still want to have that distinction of that type of area as opposed to merging the two types. I think you want to take the one and make it as accommodating as possible, but I don't know if you want to give up the other. Something about that feels like it's going to be hard to go back if you do that. I don't know.
I agree wholeheartedly, because you take a place like Pine Street, commercial first floor, residential on the upper floors, commercial first two floors above that, that makes all the sense in the world. But if the market conditions at some point favor residential over industrial, and somebody takes one of the buildings that's currently on the market in the industrial park, knocks it down, builds a five-story residential building with commercial on the first floor, I don't think you want that in the industrial park. Which I don't know that that would ever happen, but that's what could happen, and right now it can't happen. I think, I don't know if there's, can we make OI more amenable to developers and just leave GI alone?
Testing, any more opinions?
From a streamlining perspective, I completely get it. I mean, it seems really logical to merge these. I don't have quite as many concerns, I guess, about the change to GI, only because it seems like it then kind of sets up this potential for having to rezone particular parcels, or, you know, if something comes up, if something is GI, and it really is legitimately could be, you know, and have an expanded use that's not traditionally industrial, then is it more work to have to rezone particular parcels to OI as opposed to just having one industrial zone? I don't know. I mean, my familiarity with the industrial zone is primarily the industrial park and the non-conforming, you know, residential area up there, Montessori school, things like that. And, you know, it does seem like it's safe to say that there are certain industrial uses, like making concrete, that are not coming back. And so is there some hybrid single industrial zone that's going to meet all of our needs? But I think that there is a strong case for the streamlining aspect, because we know how many projects are coming through this office. If there is a way to kind of make it a little bit more straightforward for developers, I think that is very valuable.
It seems that the larger ones are difficult to negotiate to develop, right? Is that an impression I have?
The larger buildings?
Yeah, those are the ones that tend to be more intimidating.
Yeah.
Those are the ones who are industrial, right?
Office industrial, I don't think general industrial.
Awesome.
Mostly, the historic multi-story buildings are all office industrial.
It seems like there is a sort of middle ground here where maybe some of the GI does get carved off to be the OI, and then relax the OI to make it easy, but keep some GI, which just makes sense. It's like, hey, those are the areas where, for whatever reason, we can anticipate what industrial changes may or may not happen.
So if we did that, we're brainstorming a lot of things. It would probably be the industrial park and the package incorporation of Route 5 would be the ones that would stay GI, and everything else would be the ones that the few GIs that are left everywhere else.
So the Route 10 corridor in Hampton, which was the that would just be a lot.
That would be my suggestion, yeah. Because using the example, if somebody wanted to build one story of offices and four story houses, that would be fine. So it's really, I get, the only place where you attract traditional one-story manufacturer is the industrial park and packaging corporations in the floodplain. Mm-hmm. So those two, I wouldn't mind redoing those, but at least I understand the logic of that. Mm-hmm. The old business park site, the lane construction site off Dana Road, and then everything in Florence and Leeds, to me those would be fine if someone wanted to build a four-story.
Yeah.
I just wouldn't want to encourage, not that it would happen, but, you know, for Coca-Cola to build apartments on the upper floors for their resident engineers, you know, that's just wrong. That doesn't belong there. You know what I mean? And I don't think we should open that door. I don't see the need for that.
There may be residential in there now by the back door because it's in there. But with those big trucks and all the rest of what's there, I think it's just a bad mix. I wouldn't manage that at all.
Yeah, and but it's happening on Pine Street, or, you know, it's happening now because it's not a live-work situation. But to force a developer who wants to do something to fill that whole building with commercial, that's not realistic. So if we can find a happy mix, if that makes sense, we should promote that.
Yeah.
But I don't know that we need to promote that mix in the industrial park.
Okay. Well, maybe we can come back with a map, a different map, and then the proposed language change. You can look at both the general list at that time. While we're talking about map changes, there were two others that I was doing blow-ups for industrial changes. One is, and it's along the same vein, really, is you all know the Wireworks building behind the high school? At the corner of Federal and Milton Street. That's actually also partially residential, and in the back, it backs up to the Mill River, so it's special conservancy on the back side.
People working out there are Works driving school, right? That one?
Yes.
Oh, really?
The idea is, I mean, that building, you all know, languished for years. So at the time that we're looking at these changes to the OI district, we thought it would be appropriate to bring that into office industrial because they're hemmed in by the grandfathering. So it's every time they want another change, they need to come to the zoning board if it's outside the parameters of the permit that they originally received. And nothing has really gotten off the ground except for the tiny bit of it. So the idea would be to take the building section of it. Now that lot is huge. It goes all the way along Riverside Drive and on the other side of the river. But what we would propose is just the building site and the abutting parking lot, which is a separate parcel, to rezone to office industrial, and then with a floodplain overlay and flood out special conservancy. And then the rest of the parcel would still remain urban residential. We not pull in the parking lot across the street that's overgrown with weeds, because that could be a viable residential reuse on that corner.
And you're giving up on the idea that this lot would ever be in the future of residential use?
Yeah, I mean, I think.
Is that building so fine that we need to protect it?
There are pieces of it. I mean, what you saw, I think where the driving school is just a cinder block box. I think that's the piece of it. But behind that is a quite a big, I've never toured it. I don't think you've been there.
20 years?
Yeah. You know where I'm saying is it's odd sitting in the middle of a residential area. Should we not be going towards residential instead of fostering the office industrial?
I mean, that's a good question. However, it's been under the same ownership and investment owner for the last 10 years, and nothing has been done to try to
do that.
Push that.
Yeah.
So now could it be residential? No, you can't.
So right now, residentially, in some ways, the OI with the other change we're talking about would actually be more friendly for multifamily residential, because the current zoning assumes 8 units per acre, 12 units per acre.
Right. The other pieces, there might need to be, I mean, depending on how you configure it for residential, you might need to do demo. It's right up to the river, so potentially there's more resource impact with, you know, demolition of the building and restructuring the parking and all that. So
what's in it? What are they doing?
Don't know. Okay. All I know is the one driving school used. Do you know if there's?
I don't know. I think it's largely. There may be some uses.
Well, and I hear myself dreaming for what I think it could come before us to go there, which is not likely. So.
Yeah, and I don't know. I mean, the other, I guess the same could be said, I think, for the
parking lot across the street. I have no idea. I mean, that seems very well suited for residential. I don't know why that hasn't moved, but for the owner is probably thinking about the whole package and concerned about protecting that as parking, but for the views, but nothing has materialized.
Carolyn and I just did a tour of four big mill buildings in East Hampton, you know, eastwards down to Mill 180. And it's really impressive how much stuff they've done there. And the residential has really paid some of the bills for residents. So it's that cost subsidy sort of made it possible.
Mm-hmm. It's very difficult. Mm-hmm. Doing this to compete with that sort of mm-hmm. excess that is, or the attractiveness of East Hampton.
It's starting on the
The other piece is down on the other end of Riverside Drive, right where it turns again to Upton Nonatech Street. So there are four residential lots, and that's the other halfway.
On where Monty Electric was?
Yes. Not that building, but there are one, two, three, four, five, six. Residential houses. They're all the ones that are in that blue border are single family homes. And I'm not sure that it makes sense to continue with a general industrial zone for something that may never happen. They seem to be viable residential properties. And so there are two bordering blocks there. The back half is floodplain, so we're pitching that the back half come out of the overlay and go into special conservancy, so that's protected.
That's the orange.
The orange.
The orange, and then the blue is the area outside the floodplain that contains the structures and the lots.
And then the
URB, which is what the surrounding residential district is.
Yeah.
And it is currently general industrial.
Oh, so on the first of the discussion points, I feel like you're coming back to us after having heard about the industrial zone. On the second for Federal and Riverside, do you want to vote? Do you want to? I mean, what do you?
We're going to vote. I wanted to get an idea of whether this makes sense, and then we come to a formal. Introduction, you know, ordinance language, which I've started to put together, but I want to have the conversation first. We also need to, the other piece about the Federal and Milton is that it's in the neighborhood, and so we need to do a lot of outreach before that's actually introduced too. So we need to have meetings with Bay State. Mm-hmm. So what I would suggest is that we, you know, I can set up meetings. It would be great to have planning board members at those meetings, but sort of the next step isn't actually to introduce it for rezoning, it's really to go in the neighborhood and say, are you comfortable with this?
Yeah. That's considered basic?
Yes.
I guess I just thought Riverside Drive was the demarcation.
And at the same time, you talk about the other zoning on the other end, bringing it into URB.
I think it's important to be clear on what the benefits are. You know, why, big question, why would you want to make a change?
Yeah. So that would be the next step. We probably would hold off on, I can send you draft language about the modifications to office industrial so you can see what that looks like. Not the merge portion, but just a wide change. And review that at the same time. I would set up meetings with the neighborhood association just to get that conversation started.
Any other thoughts?
No.
Last but not least. The area in red is currently general business, and it starts at Holyoke Street. It also is approximately the boundary of, so that William Street North is where the massive restraint that we just received for all the improvements on those streets starts basically just a few feet south of William Street. And that's all Central Business.
We go to the Oh, I'm sorry, in terms of masters.
Right. But the general, right. So the Masters Grant is starts at Hockman Road. The central business boundary is Holyoke, so it's one block into that area where the grant covers. So the idea is really sort of extending the gateway down to the entry, you know, the new roundabout entry over Dyke. And the differences between, so I guess it's really about scaling and encouraging new sort of more intense development. General business and central business aren't that different except for setback requirements. If there's a build two line in central business districts, so you can be right on the street. You go much taller, you go to 65 feet now in the central business district. And it's really about sort of creating a more intense commercial corridor once you enter the city as kind of sort of the gateway really
on the street. What about
So there are two different ordinances, but we have consistently, when we've expanded the central business district, we've also expanded the central business architecture boundary to be consistent with the CB district. Interestingly, the central business architecture committee has just begun a process of reevaluating or re-looking at those guidelines, and it's been about 18 years that they've been in place, and we've expanded the district at various times, little bits here and there, and so down State Street, up West Street a little bit, so some of the characteristics of Main Street corridor and Pleasant Street Central, sort of right in that intersection area, are different, and the committee is now looking at reevaluating standards, maybe creating sub-districts based on not only the fact that there are, mostly the fact that we have new buildings now that don't fit those classifications that necessarily that were originally created. So I think it would be a good time to also think about maybe the different parts of the subject business district that would have different design standards.
That's very different out here than it is in town. So if we were to do this, I think that would be a pretty important parallel activity.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. On the north side, coming out of Main Street to Kingston Street, headed out, we recently changed, and I can't remember, we used to have a transitional out of central business.
Right.
Did we get rid of that?
No, it's still there.
Okay.
So we have an entrance business district.
So why not have why not replicate that on the south side? Why go right off of 91?
So one of the challenges on Pleasant Street is development area is very thin. The area in King Street, it was thicker, so people wanted to build their buildings further back. So you really don't have the opportunity to do that. The entrance business wouldn't do you much good at that. And in some ways, the bigger challenge on Pleasant Street, you know, and King Street, you can assemble property. You know, the old Honda site is a 4 or 5 acre site. Pleasant Street is the opposite problem. Tiny little lots, it's hard to assemble into the central business district, almost total lack of dimensional standards, and ability to find a lot of not requiring parking are all really unlock some of the properties on Pleasant Street. Now, it's a tiny $30 million investment coming on right now on Pleasant Street between like public projects and private projects. So it's a great draw.
Why not include, is it White Avenue?
Right.
That little cluster, it's residential, but it's within this giant red block of.
So when we last expanded our business districts, we got shot down from it. It was a real good. So our experience with Hamp, because obviously we visit, has been going from one business district to another, allowing more intense use, has not been a difficult sell. People like those opportunities. But doing anything which would potentially encourage people to tear down residential buildings scares people. On the right avenue is all residential.
Yeah.
So that was the reason we didn't do it. We lost 5 years ago, and that's the reason we weren't going to bring it up.
Lost legally or lost with public opinion?
Lost with city council. It was a debate. And I, you know, they persuaded us, so they weren't wrong.
It wasn't something that you did, and it's not legal challenge or something like that.
And in fact, there's a tiny bit of right avenue that's on the east side of Pleasant Street, just two buildings, and those we did rezone. They were so small.
Which makes sense.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Any questions for us?
What do you guys think?
I just one thing we have to say. So as part of the MassWorks project, we've now taken over Pleasant Street. It used to be the city's layout, and then Holyoke Street, we've extended it to Hawking Road. The deal the city worked out with the state to leverage them to do the roundabout is we would take over the Pleasant Street all the way down to the dike, and once the roundabout was done, we started that process. So that fits this as well, because as long as it's a state highway, we can't have on-street parking. When we take it over to on-street parking, which again fits the central, it's too narrow for on-street parking on both sides of the street, but we could probably do it.
That's true. Well, what's the feedback been on the roundabout?
People are probably, yeah. The first couple of weeks, people were really confused, and people inside were yielding to people entering. But once they did the line painting, it seems so calm. Yeah. One person's already driven across the middle, and it seems
like that's
there's a shock.
Oh, really?
There's a Pleasant Street sign.
Oh, that's great.
It's great.
How, so when's what's the timetable on the roundabout at Damon Road?
At Damon Street? Let's go through the process. They had the 25% public hearing. I think 2019 construction year, but there's a lot of right-of-way, which slows everything down, so it's probably going to fall back.
Where? Damon Road, King Street, D'Angelo's, Pride Station.
Where the
were they just where they just did?
That's not a roundabout.
Right, that's not a roundabout.
So okay. Oh, I thought that was a roundabout.
No, there's two roundabouts they're playing. Damon Road and Bridge Street, which I thought you were talking
about. Oh, right at the bridge.
Yeah. By the bridge, by Coolidge Bridge. And that's going to be two-lane.
That's where the bus is.
And then North King Street by Hatfield is going to be a roundabout as well. They're about the right time schedule. But the one where they just redid the signal, they're going to tinker with more of that's going to be
okay. That's right. That's wrong.
North King.
By the food co-op. So where Hatfield comes in, North King, right. South the food co-op.
Do you put a roundabout there?
It's a bad left turn.
Yeah. It's a bad left turn, and because it's a bad left turn, people who should take that shortcut go down to the Damon Road intersection. Right. That makes that worse. We want to encourage people to shortcut.
So back to the subject at hand.
Do you need a motion, or do you want to just...
No, I don't know.
So it sounds like there's general agreement with everything, but the industrial park. Right. Yeah.
Can I get sort of a nod for...
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh,
yeah. You'll catch on.
So yeah, I think we'd like to think again or debate again the industrial zoning. But the rest of us seem to be able to...
Fair enough.
Move to adjourn.
Thank you.
I knew there was a break in applause there for something.